leave it up to them to complete the introduction. Everybody, give them a warm welcome.
Okay, so this is our talk's half an hour. Depending on how we get on, we may hopefully have about 5 minutes time for questions at the end. Both Sean and I are going over to Headrow House afterwards, so if you don't get a chance to ask a question and want to talk to us in the pub, come and talk to us. We're going to talk about Firebreak, what we did with NHS UK for 2 weeks in December last year. This is the agenda, so we're going to briefly introduce ourselves, we're going to tell you about where we work, we're going to tell you about how we got support to be able to do the Firebreak as a concept in our organisation. And you'll see as we start talking about it, it's quite a significant thing to do. We had two events that sort of bookended the actual Firebreak to set it up and then to have a retrospective about it. And we're also going to talk to you about what we do differently next time if we had the chance. So things that went well, what we perpetuate, and things that we could have done better. So if you guys want to do something similar in your organisation, some tips from us having done it for the first time in ours. So, introductions. My job title is Programme Manager at NHS UK. I look after the project and delivery managers for our live service. I look after the PMO and the BAs, as well as doing prioritisation and some governance work for the organisation.
John, I'm the Dev Manager at NHS UK. We have about 30-odd devs at the moment, and I've been around mostly in Leeds, to be fair. I think nearly all of those things, apart from Kellogg's, were based in Leeds. So I've been a developer from that background for about the last 20 years or something like that.
So the company we work for now is NHS Digital. Who's heard of NHS Digital? Excellent. Who's heard of NHS Choices? Oh, that's good. More than I was expecting. So people that have heard of NHS Choices will know that it's the brand name for the NHS website. Traditionally, we've been a sort of an information website where you can go and look up conditions, you can go and look up NHS services and that kind of thing. We're moving to a more sort of transactional-based website, but we are the biggest health and well-being website in Europe. It fluctuates, but at the moment we're getting between 47 and 52 million visitors every month. We're 10 years old in June, and we've got a massive, almost 43,500 pages of content. Across the whole of the program, we've got about 140 staff, and the Firebreak that we did last year, we opened it up to absolutely everybody. So we had two conditions. Live service comes first. So if there's some sort of outage, I'm afraid that comes ahead of Firebreak. And if you've got any external commitments that are have got a fixed date, then those must be honoured before you can take part in the Firebreak. But actually, we got about 3/4 of that 140 staff base to take part in it, which we thought was excellent.
So the first thing we had to do was get somebody to agree that we could do this. So, so this bit's about how we got the support. So the first thing we did was we looked backwards. So lots of well-known companies have done this kind of innovation stuff. So different people have done different things for different lengths of time. So there's obviously the famous Google 20% time that apparently was only 120% time. It wasn't really 20% time. So they just made people work extra, I think. But so Redgate do sort of innovation weeks. There's Atlassian, I think they were called FedEx days, but then they're now called Ship It days. And they were like 24 hours of have the idea, build it, organize your team and everything in 24 hours. And we've done we didn't do something similar in the background. So we did something, we call it 10% time. When we had Friday afternoons where people could, if they could pitch us an idea, so it was a bit like a Dragon's Den type thing, and then they could work for, people did it for a month, up to 3 months on a Friday afternoon, doing, developing products. And some of the things actually made it into live. Some of our we made our site a lot more accessible and responsive as part of the 10% time. So as well as looking backwards, we looked around. So we realised that if we're going to get management to agree, then we need to kind of address some of the current issues that we're facing in the team. So I think there was, we went through a period where it was very sort of, the work we were doing was very progressive, but it wasn't very innovative. It was just kind of business as usual stuff. So it was a way of actually, and it was a lot of it came from external stakeholders as well. So it was an idea about how we can, and we could let the voices, you know, the grassroots voices, come through. Our site is, as you can see, me and Chris, you know, we're normally 200 odd miles apart. We're only one half the stage apart now. But, you know, our teams is always been split between Leeds and London. So the main technical team is based in Leeds. The main business team is based in London. It's a bit more mixed now than it was. But at one time, it was literally technical Leeds, business London, that was it. So there were some people that, as part of this Firebreak, had worked on different things together, never met. So it was a way of dealing with that. And we also were going through a stage where we went through a bit of a merger with our program, where we've kind of got a bunch of sort of transformational beta people, and we've got some of our old sort of live service people, and we kind of, it was a good idea to mix those two together. And then we also look forward. So we, you know, obviously, we can't use the latest, greatest thing all the time as part of a national system or a national website. So we let people, you know, it was an opportunity to let people do what they wanted to do. And also, in that spirit, we didn't have project managers and things organising people. The people that had the ideas organised themselves. So the next key thing was we got some support from sort of two key stakeholders. So we got Rachel, who's our delivery director.
Yeah, she's our big boss. So she's next one up from our program head.
And Andy Callow is the head of technical delivery, who is my boss. So the first thing we needed to do was find some ideas. And obviously when we started, we thought people did have ideas, but we weren't sure. So it was a bit like, when people, you know, like Roy said, when people, you know, people are going to turn up, are they going to turn up? You know, so you don't really know. So we decided we're going to have to generate lots and lots of ideas, and not just technical things, so not just cool apps and widgets and things. So there was ideas about changing processes, about making things just that a bit more efficient. So it's something that takes an hour, could take half an hour. If you do it a lot, it makes a big saving. And there was also some true innovation ideas as well. And we wanted to generate more ideas than we could possibly do in our time period, so that we could give people a choice about what they wanted to work on. So we've still got a bank of ideas that didn't quite make it for whatever reason. There just wasn't quite that much interest, or there was something more interesting that people wanted to work on. So we want to try and do this going forward, so that we haven't lost any of those ideas. We've kept them. And we went to and fro with Rachel and Andy, and basically what we decided that we were going to do was do a complete break, which is why the name Firebreak comes from. It's a GDS term, but basically it means you dig a trench, stop the fire going through. And it was basically drawing a line in the sand and saying, 2 weeks in December, we're going to we're going to suspend all of our sort of normal processes, and apart from live service and critical stuff. And we kicked it off with a hustings event where we did some of that. We're going to talk about that in a minute. And then we had a show and tell at the end. So in that 2 week period, we had a hustings. Then we had a sort of a couple of weeks before we started to get things organised, and then we had that 2 week break.
And it's quite important not to underplay the significance of this. So the whole organisation, 140 people, with the exception of folks that had live service commitments, we got permission to stop work, down tools on all the BAU stuff that we've been penciled in on project plans and whatever, and allow people to work on what they wanted to do, which is a, you know, it's a first for a public sector organisation like ours. You know, you hear about these sort of things in Google, but to do it in the NHS, it's very significant for us.
All those meetings that just didn't happen.
Yeah, yeah. All the paperwork that didn't get signed, the forms that didn't get filled in for a fortnight. Yeah.
Shocking. Right, so am I doing the hustings?
You're doing the hustings.
I'm doing the hustings. Yep. Yeah. Okay. So, so what we did, we created some ideas cards, like this, so we basically put them up on the wall. So we just kind of print them out. It's very low tech. We didn't do anything particularly exciting to start off with, and we kind of thought people can, whether they need some help or they can do it on their own, and how long they think it's going to take out of the 2 weeks, and what sort of skills they would need. And, you know, we generated...
And this is all, if you had an idea, this is all you needed. You didn't need your manager's approval, you didn't need, you know, logging on a system or anything like that. If you wanted to work on something, that was it. Pen, 2 minutes, on the wall.
And so we went branding crazy, and we really painted NHS Digital red, really, for that period of time. So one of the problems we found was that people had half an idea. So they kind of wanted to do, people either wanted to do something and didn't know what to do, or some people had half an idea, didn't know how they would make it a reality. So we held our sort of ideas clinics on a Friday. It was like a WebEx thing, because we did, you know, we had like 50 or 60 people on some of them. And, you know, it was a way for people to talk through their ideas and people to offer. So it wasn't really moderated particularly. It was like somebody go, you know, well, I'm really looking to do something, but I don't know what to do. And then people go, why don't you do, you know, lots about this. Why don't you do something like that? So it was quite a free-flowing thing, but it did help people sort of get over that inertia about how do I do something.
Some people just wanted to know who to talk to. You know, I've got an idea about this part of the business, but I don't know who runs that part of the business. And they just come on the phone call, we match people up, and off they went.
And some people just wanted a mate to do it with,
yeah.
Sometimes, you know, to the partner, because, you know, it's a bit less scary when you do things together. So so we also recruited some ambassadors as well. So we decided that, you know, we weren't really going to do this on our own. So we had about a dozen or so. And they sort of chipped in with various things, you know, organising some of the admin-y bits that went around it, and organising some meetings, making sure people had updated their ideas and stuff like that. The next thing we did was we got everybody to one location. So
we're predominantly based here, Leeds, London. We also have about 15 a dozen people down in Southampton, and one person in Exeter, which is down there somewhere. geographically diverse, and as Sean said, getting, you know, 60, 70 people from there, meeting up with 60, 70 people from there in one central location. Some of them have been working with folks for 3, 4, 5 years. It's the first time they've met face to face. And actually, we found that, you know, you hear quite a lot in talks at Agile Yorkshire and stuff about being co-located as teams. Actually getting people together in one place was, I think, one of the key success points for making this happen.
So basically, people had 2 minutes to pitch their idea, and, you know, there was a whole day of people doing some of that. We also provided time for people to talk to each other. You know, there's a happy bunch of people, and they're all mixed. It's like, you know, the developers, groups of developers there, and groups of content people down here and stuff. But in the end, it was all kind of mixed up, and so people did kind of mingle quite a lot. And then we had printed out some stickers, people basically had 9 days, because the last day was the show and tell. So we had they had 9 stickers and they could go and stick their stickers on whatever ideas they wanted to work on and put the names on. The actual ones had the space for the name on. So it was a bit like, it was a bit like mad sticker heaven, wasn't it? When we kind of went, we had multiple rounds of people doing that. So, and as soon as the ideas got funded, we kind of moved those to one side. So, so we banked all our fully resourced ideas, and now we have, with a bit of luck, a short video.
I think the key kind of focus for me is about creating collaboration between the two teams. So we've had a live service team and we've got a program team who have been working in very different ways to date. So physically bringing 100 people together in one environment is powerful. The session today, this morning, has been about working together and creating a safe space for people to share ideas. And there's been some fantastic suggestions on what we do.
People have got, they have got lots of ideas, they want them to improve things, but not necessarily have the opportunity to do it. By giving them an opportunity to work together on things that they're really interested in rather than what they're being told to, you know, will help sort of release some of that creativity.
My idea is to create an interactive email interface that allows practice managers to update their information or to validate the information within the email. So there's no need to log into their profile anymore or find anything. They just can do it in one go.
What I wanted to do was to kind of use the sort of NHS network in order to kind of source better photography that we can use in our content, but also distribute out to other organisations.
We had 50 different ideas across a whole broad range of different things, from process improvement to technology innovation to, you know, generating new applications that may one day go live on the website. So yes, amazing.
You don't often actually see the people you're speaking to every day, so it was good to be able to put face to a name, and also it's good when the business is this big to get everyone together in one place.
It's incredibly important to me that we have fun while we're at work, so we're all at work for far too many hours. It's, you know, absolutely key that people do pull together, we have fun, but, you know, overriding, we absolutely must deliver.
The energy levels in the room were brilliant, everyone was encouraging each other. I think if we continue that spirit over the 2 weeks of the Firebreak, it's going to be superb.
Right.
So, The hustings event was what we used to set up the Firebreak. So we had about 50 ideas. Incidentally, most of the ideas were sensible. We had
two that weren't sensible.
I think one of them was to put a widget in the toilets. We've got one building where the toilets are quite overused. To put a toilet monitor widget in place so that you could see from your desk when there was a free toilet. So there were only two of those. The rest of the ideas were all around how we could do things better, offer better services to our customers. They were all really sensible. And given that we had 140 people, of which just over 100 took part, to get 50, just under 50 sensible ideas was a good achievement. So we had the hustings event, we matched people with ideas, so the ideas owners had a cohort of people that were committed to working on their idea. That was, I think, about 2 weeks before we actually had the Firebreak. And then from the 5th to the 15th of December, we down tools on all of the BAU stuff, and we started working on the ideas that have been submitted. We'll talk later on about lessons learned. It wasn't as easy as that, it wasn't quite as smooth. A lot of the ideas owners we learned didn't have experience about running teams, so we gave them 3, 4, 8, 9, 10 people, but then they didn't know where to start because they'd not run a project team before. So we had our 2 weeks, and what we did at the end. So the only condition about having the idea get off the ground, apart from you've got to resource it, was you had to come back to Peterborough. Again, we got people in multiple locations back in the middle of the country. You had to come back and just present how it went, whether it was good, whether it worked, whether it's bad, whether it didn't work, and the reasons why it was good or bad. So similar event, people got up and we asked them to present back what they'd done over the last 2 weeks. I think there was a mix. So we had some people, the ideas owners, presented their end product as an idea owner, but about half the people actually got up as teams. So they felt quite a good sense of belonging, having been brought together and self-organising and working on stuff that they wanted to do. So everybody in the team got up and presented back, which was great. So it was a day of presentations. So we had morning and afternoon with people doing this kind of PowerPointy type stuff. Over the lunch break, we had quite a few people that had things that you could demonstrate and interact with. Sean's idea, for example, was the Amazon Alexa thing, to do a bit of a diagnostic. So, Alexa, can you tell me symptoms of chickenpox and that kind of thing, with a API into the information we already had on the website. So, presentations, stuff that people could interact with, so they could see what had been produced, but also so the ideas owners could get some instant feedback. You know, very agile. This is what we've done. It's a sort of an MVP or a beta. How have you found it? Give us some feedback. And it was just before Christmas, so we had silly hats and mince pies and that kind of thing as well. So yes, as I said, the focus was presenting back what you'd done in the previous 2 weeks. A lot of the people talked about how they got to from starting to the end of the 2 weeks. So a lot of the slides were, you know, we did this as a team, we collaborated, we went out and did some guerrilla user research in the canteen, that kind of stuff, rather than just a dry, we've built this, we've improved that.
We still use lots of post-its.
And we still use lots of post-its.
Turn the lights off and we'll do the videos.
And we've got a video.
I think the energy and the enthusiasm of everybody over the last couple of weeks has been fantastic. It's really brought the teams together, and a lot of people have worked on projects that, you know, not necessarily would they have even known each other before. So the actual output of the session is absolutely fantastic.
Really, really good. Amazing what progress people have made when, you know, they're under a very sort of tight time scale, being very creative about using their time and arranging different people's input into those ideas in different ways. And, you know, it's just been great to celebrate their achievements over this time. You know, but we've learnt a lot around how we might do things differently next time as well.
So we've got a couple of external CIOs with us today. And they were asking me in the break, you know, what do you want us to talk about, Rach? And I said, talk about innovation, some of the stuff that you guys do within your own organisation. And both of them have said, we will struggle to come up with things that are better than what you guys are doing right now.
There's quite a lot of ideas that we've seen today that can filter through into live service, efficiency things or sort of new features that are being added to the service that we deliver. My encouragement will be to people to just get on and do that and use some of those connections and some of those relationships that they've built to continue to do that stuff. Let's not wait until the next Firebreak in order to progress that. You know, we can do some of it now.
The highlights of the Firebreak have been just getting to work with new technologies and new people and doing stuff outside of my daily work and things that I think will be beneficial to my career progression.
I guess the highlight for me has been the sort of opportunity for a lot more collaboration than we often get. Really nice to try and put some time aside, get involved with other people that you wouldn't necessarily have to get involved with, and be able to do something that is kind of more important to you, you know, whether it was particularly innovative or just trying to kind of fix something or improve something that we already have. That was a really good opportunity, I think. I've just got my free souvenir mug as well, which I'm very excited about.
Today, so far, has been good. It's been exhilarating. We've had some good conversations, some great ideas, great innovation. And I've been impressed with the people, what they've done and what they've presented.
Firebreak, would I do it again? Absolutely. It's been a superb achievement. If I was to make one improvement to the experience, it would be in bringing partner organisations like NHS England, maybe Department of Health into the mix, and possibly some of the startups in the health tech space.
So we're going to start talking about what went well. So we've immediately, almost straight after the event, we did some, start to do some benefits realization of things that we've done. And just for the three ideas that we measured at the time, we've already saved £24,000. There was something around speeding up one of the processes for the service desk that saved hundreds of hours, man hours a year. What was the one? There was
Something around a process for reusing software licenses. So rather than having periodic audits where kit that had been decommissioned, we released the licenses, the infrastructure team put in place something where there was a process to actually acknowledge that that license was no longer needed, so we weren't paying for it. It's basic stuff, but we didn't have the time to dedicate to putting that process in place until Firebreak.
One of the things, I mean, it was in the video, the atmosphere was brilliant. The people, people, a range of people, a bit, some people are really up for it, some people not. But the energy was amazing in the room. So we also thought that 2 weeks was a really good time length to do it. So I think if we'd just done a week, it wouldn't have been as powerful. It also gave people the opportunity to work on more than one thing. But that has a downside as well. I think we'll talk about that in a minute. But, I think GDS did a month, which might have been a bit long. We might have struggled to get that through. But it seemed like a good sort of halfway house between, doing it just for a day or a week and then doing it for a month. So there's the team building stuff. There's people who, there's lots of benefits in a business for people having those strong relationships. It's not about managers, it's about people talking to each other. Powered people. So I think people felt a little bit more in control of sometimes when the priorities come down to you from the Department of Health or NHS England, and you're like, well, we should just be doing this, really. I think people felt that they had the opportunity to do that, and it got recognised by management as maybe they've got some good ideas as well. Maybe it doesn't need to be the hippos, whatever the hippo voices. So we also, but because we're the NHS, we were about spending some money, but the memento thing went down really well. People still it's very useful for a start, it was a really good reminder for people, even over 6 months on now almost, it's still a good reminder for people. What's that? What happened? What was this about? And then you get to tell the story again, you see. So we also made ourselves more visible. We're not always seen to be the most forward-thinking and innovative kind of organisation, being part of the NHS, being part of the sort of the civil service and things like that. But we've used Twitter and Medium, and there's blogs and stuff that we can kind of direct people to afterwards if they're interested. It did raise our profile. People were, what are you doing? These kind of things now. So, and the last thing that we did went well. We had people that really thought it was going to be a disaster, and nothing would get done, and it would just be people playing for 2 weeks. And some of those people came back to us and actually went, actually we were wrong. We did have a negative view of it at first, but after taking part in it, when's the next one, kind of thing.
So the stuff that we do differently next time. And there is going to be a next time. So we're planning our next one in October of this year. So we always knew that it was very likely to be a good idea. But what we did was we rushed into it a little bit. So I think had Sean and I had a bit more time to prepare it and do a plan, once we've got permission to do it, I think. So we thought it could have been better organised. We got lots of feedback saying that nobody noticed that it was badly organised at all. it's true, but it's like the Swan thing. So we were, we had weeks where
busy week, didn't we?
We didn't do anything else prior to the Firebreak, but everyone thought it was smooth, but we'd organise it better next time.
Also, lead time before you tell people about it, so that there's people that wanted to take part that couldn't because they had deliverables in the looking at Eve now.
Yeah.
What you wanted to do stuff. She had ideas, she gave her ideas away, all sorts of things. But, you know, so giving people that lead time so that the business can organise itself to give you that space is important. So that's why we've kind of decided we're going to do October, and we've got six yes. months now to... There's no excuse this time, okay? I mean, there's bound to be some things, but anyway.
So picking a better time of year. So we picked December because we thought it's going to be quiet. There's not going to be so much in terms of company deliverables that we have to do. Actually, it was quite a bad time. There were people ramping up for Christmas. There were people that took time off, so couldn't participate. We've got one area that's about 10% of our work who they're highly focused towards sort of Christmas and New Year type campaigns. So that's Eva's team. They were just excluded straight away. So we've chosen October this time because we're clear of summer holidays. So there'll be people in the office. We're clear of the sort of traditional deadline times of year because we have cycles of deliverables. And as Sean said, it gives us more time to prepare. So generating ideas wasn't a problem. As I said before, we got about one idea for every two people in the staff base. But what we found is that the idea owners, while they could generate good ideas, what they really needed our help with was how to form a team to bring that idea to reality. And we left ourselves about 2 weeks, I think, to actually help the idea owners set up prior to the 2 week firebreak period. So having a better period to triage the idea and set it up ready for when people are free to work on it. The ambassadors and the idea owners, I'd say Sean and I almost gave up probably a month between us of dedicating ourselves to planning this prior to the actual firebreak, which, you know, we hadn't banked on. Getting people who could act as ambassadors, almost like one representative per team to actually help do the sort of stuff that Sean and I were doing would be something that we do better next time.
And I think also we found that there wasn't enough project managers, which is a really weird thing. Because, you know, some of the ideas that went better than others, they had project managers involved in them that, you know, who'd have thunk? They kind of, you know, organise things and stuff. And, you know, their value really came through. And I'm not just saying that because Chrissy stood over there. But, you know, but we kind of, we parachuted project managers into other teams to help them out in the middle of the thing, just because, you know, some people had these brilliant ideas, they had loads of people, and it's like, but I don't know what to, you know, they just have no experience of doing it. So, you know, there is a skill there.
It was great for my team because people were, you know, prior to Firebreak, people were saying, well, why do we need project managers? We've got these agile, we're all agile now. We've got these self-organising teams. They can just go off and manage themselves. We kind of proved that, you know, when as an organisation, we're not quite that far advanced and people still need organising to produce stuff. So we gave people stickers to allocate to ideas, and we gave them stickers in chunks of one day to allocate to each idea. Next time we'd limit it to you can work on two ideas rather than up to 9 or 10 ideas. If we'd have organised it better beforehand, we'd have done a traditional project management Gantt chart with resources allocated to ideas and that kind of thing, and it would have all been stage managed. No, it wouldn't. That wouldn't have worked either. But giving people the ability to work on 9 things at once may sound exciting, but the reality is you can probably only concentrate on a couple for that sort of period of time. We started off with about 50 ideas. We actually delivered on 37, I think, so a good proportion of them. But there were a few ideas that were really, really popular that got over-allocated. So next time, some better mechanism of cutting off to say when an idea is in the bank and we're going to do it. Resource planning I've already spoken about, so we can skip that one. We did some reading up of how people had done it before. We looked at blog articles and that kind of thing, and we discussed how we do it ourselves. I think we'd have benefited from going to actually talk to organisations that had done it before. We wanted to. We had every intention of, but we didn't have enough time to plan it, so we would have talked to people who'd done this sort of thing before next time. And this is probably... This slide and the next point, for me personally, are probably the biggest failings that we had, or the things to concentrate on next time. So we generated all this momentum, all this energy. People were happy to give their time to do all this innovative type work. We finished it with a show and tell on the 16th of December. We broke for Christmas, and we were back to normal in January. So we had 37 odd ideas, where some of them, like the £27,000 for three ideas, that was saved by the end of the 2 weeks, so the thing paid for itself. But there were lots of things that we produced an alpha for, but we didn't follow up to see how it could be put live. There were things where we'd got a few ideas that people had workshopped ideas on how to do things better, come up with a plan, but we didn't follow up to put that plan into reality. So there's a whole load of ideas that will make a big difference to how we work, but we went back to our day job, we went back to BAU too soon. And the last slide on the benefits, I'm from a project management background, as Sean has alluded to, and benefits realisation is one of the things that we don't shout about enough. So that figure of £27,000 is good, but that was three ideas, we had 30 odd. We will have saved a lot more money than that, but we didn't log it. We will have released a few products to market, which I'm sure had we set up customer feedback in advance, we would have got great customer feedback on it. We could have learned from those products to enhance the way we do product development in the future. Not enough of following up on what we've done. That's it.